these aren't even notes. It's just shit I carry around with me. This. All right. Spread this around a little bit at home. Well, I want the symmetry of the sloppiness. You know, it's such a thing as organized chaos. From chaos comes organization. Aren't you glad those people who are alive can tell us that? Like, aren't you glad every time somebody says something that he learned in his last day of college? Like, I spoke to... I read for a pilot that I really, really kind of wanted. Like, being in New York, I realized I'm lucky I didn't get it. But I still want it, and I'm crying. And I had lunch with the president, because he's a fan, and it turns out he's just some guy who used to follow me around, and now he's a big shot. And it's something to eat. I feel like whenever, it never comes down to like, what's your project and what do you want to do about it? It's always like, oh, you know, you have a story about your father? I want about mine. And it is about 30 times. And I'm like, I just want money. And it's not even that. It's like, I become a Rick Shapiro yo-yo, like a tchotchke, a novelty. Like, look, I'm playing with Rick Shapiro. I'm playing with Rick Shapiro. Look how adorable he is. He lights up when you do it fast. And then he has a heart attack and a coma, and it's called Odin. And I didn't dress like this for Christmas. But I took a shit at the Columbus Circle Mall, and I figured I should steal a nice jacket, because they were out of toilet paper. And there was no Gap store where you can actually take the shirts and wipe your ass in front of everyone, and nobody says anything because they're shopping sheep. So in the meadow of mediocrity, I thought that'd be perfect for this room. Every comic I'm jealous of, that's good, okay. I know Louie and Norton aren't there, or Jay Okerson, or the guys who don't deserve it, like Colin Kane. I'll say it. That's how I've learned to argue in L.A., not like a man, like this. Like, oh, I will. As long as you talk like a girl, it's all right. It's like, really? 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 And all the guys are like, really, Rick? Really? 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 And I go, that's so weird that you say that about me, because I'm a good person. I'm a good person. All right. No, I actually just didn't want to wear a hoodie because I didn't know if George Zimmerman was in town. You know what's funny about that? That shit it never goes away. I'm walking so funny because when I'm usually fine, but the fucking dump I took triggered the Parkinson's. It was so bad. I'm like, I gotta take a dump, man. Where's the bathroom at? It's like you have to urinate. No, I got Parkinson's. Oh, that's a shit. All right, no, man. I never thought I'd be talking about shit and dumps in a prestigious city like New York. Where the models are so airbrushed, they look nine. I walked under a Gap poster and a vagina hair scratched me. Her dress was right to there, like her balls were showing. I forget what I was talking about, so it doesn't matter. I just want to say, because I wasn't going to do comedy. I didn't know what I was going to do, because I was sick for 2 fucking years, like 6 years, actually. A car accident. Like the doctor said, you've had 3 ODs, 3 comas, and 3 heart attacks. We saved your life. And I heard myself say under my breath, I heard it. I said, asshole. Like when I was on heroin and coke and Adderall, what do you think? I was trying to build a porch on my house? Build a fucking life? I wanted to die. You're in my way, asshole, in a lab coat. I'm not your experimental monkey to bring back to life at will. I'm here for you to do your job, make sure I die. You know, prognosis. Well, he's going to be suicidal if we bring him back to life. That's a prognosis. The diagnosis is just choke him. So George Zimmerman is never going to go away. He shot a kid for wearing a hoodie. I don't care what anybody says, that's what happened. He shot a boy for wearing a hoodie. Which means they should put all the Kardashians and everybody else who watches reality shows in hoodies and send them to Florida at midnight. And that situation would be solved. And I'm not voting for rich presidents anymore, rich candidates. Like yachts. Anybody who owns a yacht, I'm just going to key your kid's forehead. Fucking yachts. Yachts mean you have no rights. That's what this means. You have a party on your yacht, and that's your life. Live there and die. If I had a yacht, I would OD. I'd OD under a pile of 19-year-olds. You know, I'd be sniffing so much ass. But I just want to vote for a broke guy, a guy who's so broke that he's at home studying The Secret. Or even agape, I'll say that over for that. Or even a lesbian, because I'm in New York now, so you throw the word lesbian around and you're in. You've got it going on. You got a show called Midnight with Lesbians, Rick Shapiro. Unable to sleep with lesbians. Insomniac, but lesbians. Lesbian Insomniac. That's her stripper name, Lesbian Insomniac. Her best move was this. Oh, chick. That was her best move as a stripper. So I'm going to read some shit.
Yeah.
Even though comedy's my true love, I found out I'm a poet, and Tracy says I'm never sincere. She wanted me to come out and say, look, hi, and then read. And I did that. I did that in L.A. It's actually online. I forgot which ones I picked. I hate this. All right, here it is. And that's weird because I, of course, one. Okay. Well, should I read the best one first?
Yes.
Okay. Damn. Every part of me shut. When they said I had Parkinson's, they said, you don't have the old lady, you know, chain smoking Benson and Hedges, shaky hands down in scotches, thinking about her son Scotty in rehab, like, I hope he doesn't get molested. I hope he doesn't get molested in rehab. I hope he pulls through. You know? They say you have environmental Parkinson's. I go, what the hell is that? They go, that's from too many car crashes, fist fights, and concussions. I go, oh no, that's heroin. Then I took his Krispy Kreme and came into his poodle's eye. I always put those at the end of every joke so America knows they've got the punchline. America. $60 million for Ray Romano, and I'm on the subway saying, the people look poorer now. Remember when it looked like rich people riding the subway? They were like, now everyone's just like Precious, white and black. They're just like the white and black version of Precious. I'm not saying they should be raped by their mother. I'm not insecure, I'm vulnerable. Nobody knows what words mean anymore. What the fuck does vulnerable mean? This girl says, just be vulnerable. Just be, I said, I don't date. She goes, well, just be vulnerable. Be who you are. Be vulnerable. I said, vulnerable? I'm vulnerable. I'm an impenetrable tank of narcissism with giant wheels of loneliness about to roll over and crush you. Now pay the check. I'll eat your food, borrow your money, pay. You'll pay my rent. I forgot the rest of the joke. Plow you against my shower ceiling, break every piece of furniture with your gorgeous goddamn asshole, or I can sit down next to you, put on a pair of khakis and a performance fleece sweater and hat, and say things like, you know, we can email each other from the same table. Did you know we can email each other from the same table? You like Candy Crusher? That gets me so mad. When I think of a rock, I have to play Candy Crusher, really angry. Who's your favorite video vixen? Where don't you want to email each other from the same table? Where are you going? Don't you want to play Guitar Hero where there's no guitar and I'm the opposite of a hero? Wait, I have Blackberries are back. I've got Blackberry balls. E-pad. iPad. Personality. Nothing. Dead. I'm an angry bird. I saw all these comics playing Candy Crusher before I went on stage. I was reading about the covert activity in Iraq. And I was so angry before I went on stage, in front of me were three girls going. I said, you're texting, right? Because you're girls, that's a stereotype, and I'm a comic. And he comes out the studio like girls. And they go, no, Candy Crusher, it's just so hard. I go, yeah, right, I can tell by the tear of blood coming out of your asshole. You came here for poetry, remember that. As long as it's lyrical, doesn't matter if it's graphic. Let me try this. All right. This is a quick one to get started. You can see the rules as they walk by you. The stiff standing against the wall wondering how it all happened, not knowing its cause. They believed and wanted. You believe the moth-ridden slogans farting strongly out of weak, dead sheep's mouths. That was a waiter I observed. And I was on a date with a girl and he was just standing there like, I said, look at him, man. He's wondering how it all got this way. And the girl said, what'd she say? The girl said, I just don't think about it. And then I fucked her. That's when I had my first L.A. thought. I was like, oh, I gotta fuck her. That's how you know you want to fuck someone, when it's just this miasma in your head, like smoke, like a freebase pipe, when you don't want to do it anymore and it disgusts you, I gotta have more. And it's the same thing with a girl. I don't like her. She's not interesting. I gotta fuck her. She talks like she ripped her heart out the minute she landed at the airport in L.A. That's what they're like in L.A. The girls land in L.A., rip their hearts out of their chest, throw them on the floor, and then look for their luggage and go live. You know, like, he has a good car. He had a good car. Like, if you have a Porsche, if you use the word Porsche, do you know you're a pinhead? You know, like, I wouldn't say that I have a Porsche and be proud. I have a Porsche. You know, I would say I'm a dickhead. Like, dentist dick. That's what a Porsche is. A dentist leaning against a Porsche. You know, I have a Porsche. He doesn't have that one electron that kills me every day. Like, I'm an idiot. You know, no, he's fine. He gets a Porsche. So he writes a show, and I put Jim Gaffigan on it. This is your lady. All right. It is a weird one. This is called meeting people. This is how I'd like to meet people. Remember, it's a poem. I don't have to remind you. Anything? All right. I wish there was a podium. Meeting people. Long, tall, cool one. This your lady, man? If you was my angel, baby, I'd tear you up. You'd be smiling like, oh, come on, man. I know you two got a good thing. No one ever said I didn't say you wasn't a beauteous couple with all the happiness you deserve. I'm just trying to meet people, man. You know, baby, you know. Yeah, still ain't met the man you so long for. I know, man. You're the deal-dealio. I ain't hitting on your girlfriend. Oh, I'm saying something wrong? Yeah, what's right? You tell me. Choosing all the walks of life I chose. You tell me, motherfucker. You tell me, being alone all night long, damn it. Yeah, there is a God, he wants me to be the cool, angry loner. Baby, you're the ass-slithering represent, no, the embodiment of all mankind's belief. Man, you are the exciting, unrequited symbol of dessert. You are the real lickable cupcake. Man, if you ain't the unheard thunder resounds inside of you. Never screaming your own sex truth of erotic desires. Man, come on, lady, I'm finishing your unheard thoughts. You got this satisfaction in the form of an agitated, lonely panther. Let me finish, man. I'm just trying to make a friend. We were trying to have a conversation, an exchange of ideas. Man, if you ain't 17 poems already written, 200 paintings, and a bottle of wild pills, all in your lonely physicality. Descend, passion hawk, descend. Oh, fuck all you people. I'm just trying to have some small talk. Drown in your coffee pleasantries. Have decaf. Man, I don't know what's wrong with the people in this town. I'm just trying to make friends. Man, that's that one. Was it interesting? Was it interesting? Yeah. Okay, your story landed. I'm just going to trust it. What am I planning shit for? I'm trying to be faithful to the... This is called faithful. I'm trying to be faithful to the morality of others and be a nice guy. I'm trying to focus on my career, but when a poet sees you walk, it's insane. The madness grins and looms. Bang, bang. I just realized I never knew how to read poetry. I never knew how to read poetry. I just gave the traces in here. If I look at it, it won't come out. Bang, bang. I see your feet. I see your feet. Like a hidden musician hears the beat. A smarter-than-hell junkie starts itching. The good boy starts bitching. The drums, boom, boom, baby, boom, boom. My heart's beat is waking me, stirs me alert. Comedy is boring, your story languorously alluring. It lures me, it lures me. Boom, 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 make room. The silky confusion croons, and the silky confusion looms. Boom, wow, baby, wow. What the almost fucking hell? Hell is almost fucking you.
And then what do they do after? They look at you? Okay.
There's all kinds of shit. Damn. All right. There's a story. I picked the unserious one. Well, this is a serious thing. It's for money, but if you really think about it, it's the most serious thing going on more in the States, because in overseas, I met a lot of people, blue-collar, hard-working guys and girls that are political. They know what's going on, and they engage in conversation. And the funny thing is, Australian girls get political about America. Like one girl downed a shot and said, "It's over for your country. Come and fuck my girlfriend and me in the bathroom." And she swaggered. Her ass looked like John Wayne challenging me. You know, like, they engage in life. They talk politics. They fuck within a matter of 10 seconds. Americans, when they do threesomes, it's more like the girls are trying to be falsely defiant. Like, "Oh, you want to fuck? Well, I might want to kiss my girlfriend. Well, what do you think of that? Can you handle that? I didn't think so." You know what I mean? And in Australia, they go, the next day the girl said to me, "I painted our threesome." And I didn't know I was Americanized. And I went like, what's that going to look like? You know? Zippy the pinhead with the heart on? And she showed me the painting, and I was like, "That's fucking gorgeous. It was beautiful." Then I looked her up online. Turns out she's a fire eater, fire dancer. Like, she lives a very free, spirited life. Like, most of you guys, my friend who has this great character, I met him in Edinburgh, does this great character. Like, he already knows, most people, a lot of people have lived free, and they've met fire eaters. You know, I'm a middle-class Jew who ran away at an older age and became a prostitute after trying college. I wasn't a boy, but I was still a boy. But prostitute, drug dealer, mafia. But I never met fire eaters. Like, I grew up with that. It's like, that's not a profession. You know, so like, it fucking is. This other shit ain't professions. You know what I mean? Like, lawyers are just kinkos with better suits. You know, they're fucking scumbags. They suck. And fire eaters live. Like, I went to a club, all these models were hanging around, and they were selling fire shit, you know, they go like that, and fire rolls up and comes back. And I looked like a jerk. I didn't talk to any of the girls, and I was just like, "This is great." Like if Dance Revolution was in a club, I wouldn't be dancing with a hot girl. I'd be like, "Man, check how good I am. Check out how good I am." A girl's going to walk by and admire me. I'm sure of that. That's what happens to Jews. the bad thing that's happening in the country is this. It's a new superhero called Glibman. And these are who I met. I've had political discussions with people on, you know, mild political, no, overheated with people after a gig, it's always these handsome guys hanging around the bar trying to meet girls, and they want to talk political. And Libman and Rick are at a fancy dark restaurant with thick, elongated wooden tables, high ceilings, and raised booths. Libman, hi. This is a dialogue. Hi. I am Libman. I speak very glibly, very easily. Oh, the government. The government is awful. They're ripping us off. Oh, they're totally ripping us off. Do you think there's anything you can do about it? Oh, I thought you meant discuss it. Well, you know, have a talk. My point being, what time is it? Could you excuse me for a second? Time passes, he comes back, and he tells me, I would order the dolphin, but aren't they an endangered species? Well, why do they protect the dolphins? I mean, they are smart and used in science to learn communication with others, and they beat them on the heads. No, that's seals. Baby seals, that's right. Yeah, seals, man. You know, they even have cool milk here. It's very good. It's so good. It's made from dehydrated monkey babies that they use in experiments. Cholera. It's considered a form of seasoning. They use it in smoothies. But doesn't that bother you that they beat seals and dolphins and you're drinking cholera smoothies? Oh, it's a horrible thing. It's that point. Oh, it's a horrible thing. Like, what, you just asked me to change the channel or did you say something? Oh, it's a horrible thing. You know, they also do it to a very expensive breed of poodle species, punching feces. And kittens, too. Kittens are a delicacy in eastern Romania. They hang them by their paws and beat them on the heads. And kittens are very resilient. It takes at least 12 strokes with an extremely blunt instrument. Oh, that's horrible. Oh, it's horrid. It's a travesty. Oh, it's a complete travesty. And a tragedy as well. That would be a great board game. Travesty and tragedy. Another glib man in the booth adjacent pops his head over and addresses glib man. Why don't they make board games anymore? In Sri Lanka, they use board games for roots. That's it. Now here's good man. Here's good man as a superhero. A robber is holding a gun up to a woman. Good man enters and seizes. Are you going to shoot her? Oh, you're completely going to shoot her. You know, in South Afghanistan, you would be considered a hero for shooting an old woman, or they would waterboard you and cut your ear off. I think they do that in other countries too. The robber becomes disgusted at Goodman's reaction to the event and leaves. That's it. Some people you just don't want to hang out with, even if you're robbing someone. But, all right, here. What's this? All right, this is called Pockets. This is one of my favorites. Today I was reading the book and I was like, damn, I think this stuff is good. But, Pockets. It's about, I was watching a girl who worked at a cafe in L.A. Funny thing, amazing. I gotta tell you what's blaring at me. Blaring and glaring. Doing the blaring glare. Do you know what blaring means? You know what blaring means? Okay, just checking. Well, there was a few minutes, like the first second that immediately grabbed me. Like, slow-mo. The first sec. Then slow-mo, looking right at me. This is the power you women have. She's like water, she's butter, she's cream, her eyes glide, noticing, then landing into her, she. Her eyes glide, noticing, then landing into her, she. up and down, chin lowers, then, oh, she is the whole absolute. She is the woman, eternal girl, whose lightning bolt is then. See, look, watch it. Then, exalted, then her eyes took a quick curve. Look, a quick curve. Then her directness. Whoa. Then she smiles to herself. Man, she can do that. She fucking does it. Smiles to herself. Man. Then I get mad. Then frightened by her smile's way. Hughes, Hughes. I would have trusted. Her hair is daunting. It makes butter, water, and mist peer and watch her hair. To learn how to be butter, water, and mist. Smooth flowing, man. It's like the night reveals what the night is made of, what the night truly is when you look at her, what secrets and play are, what sultry and natural is. Sultry, natural, man, sultry, natural. Look, I bet, yeah, she's got back pockets. I imagine her slipping each hand. No, her hands. Each hand. Her hands. Each. No, her fingers. Her skin. Her fingers as she slides, glides, as she slides, glides, slides, slips. Yeah, man, that's it. She slides. She slides as she slips her hand. Her hands slide. Man, slide into her each pockets, her pockets, her each pockets, her pockets. Man, get it, get this, you motherfuckers. Her teasing, inspiring fingers, each one slowly creates more and more continuous wonder. In my gut, yours too. Don't fucking lie to me. I want to talk to her, but I can't lie to her. Everything out of her mouth was brilliant because of how her lips presented it, and her eyes expressed it, expressed herself. But was it herself? Now I'm battling with nuances. Nuances skilled with footwork and speed. But with her, no combos, just surprises, not practiced. You ever force yourself to pay attention to something you'd ordinarily ignore? Like, oh my God, look how beautiful her fingers are. Like there's, remember when you were a kid, girls smelled like rubber? They had a weird smell. They were so cute, they'd make your ears crackle. Thanks. Oh. That's that. Woo! I wasn't going to do this, but I don't know if you're going to do this. But I know because I'm workshopping it. He steps up to a podium, onto a riser, with a slide coming down, and morphine playing. Flying. This is beautiful. This is LA. Doomed to never make it. And I actually worked it out with a very depressed, denial-driven musician who only played atmosphere music, but it was like one note, like. So, it's supposed to be like this, doomed to never make it. Doomed to never make it. He's always got to fake it. We're awaiting word on two projects. They're showing a lot of interest. Things are great, things are great. We're waiting on their calls. Should happen before the fall. Next fall. No, next fall. No, not that fall. The one that's farthest away, he asked. They said, it's not that far. In 20 years, you'll have a car. And the chorus sings, just think of that. He's seen so many fakers, the bottom-feeding takers, talking about the Lakers. Hey, high five. Hey, high five. Don't leave me hanging, bro. Yeah, cut the rope. Put him down. Yeah, cut the rope. Put him down here. Oh, damn. It's Rick Shapiro. And the other guy said something worse than, who? Oh, yeah, I heard of him. I heard him once he got angry. I really liked what he did. But I never admitted it or said it out loud, because I'm an American, and that's how we crawl and hide in dark against the wall. Americans. That's cool, man. Yeah. Says, oh, screw you, man. I can't have no women friends? I mean, what the hell is it with the people around here in this town? You all drink silent coffees and drown unknowingly in your pleasantries. Oh, come on, man. I'm just trying to make conversation. Ain't that what you say, small talkers? God damn it. God damn it. Damn it. I'm so tired of being alone. I'm so tired of being alone.
You saw me standing alone, without a song in my heart, without a love of my own. Blue, 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 blue moon. You saw me standing alone. Blue moon, blue fucking moon. Fuck you. Saw me standing alone 4 a.m. for a fucking year. Blue moon, you saw me standing alone. You saw me standing alone. Blue fucking moon. Blue moon.
And that's that piece. That is that piece. That's how we all feel when we're our most drunk and we've been rejected, business, personal, and family, and money, and everything at 4 a.m. That final night we just had it all. I was walking down the street going, blue moon. I wish I had a golden Cadillac with silver ducks in the back. Blue moon. Rainbow over the rainbow, you whore. And this girl pulls up. She goes, Rick Shapiro, what are you doing? I went, oh, hi, you want to have lunch tomorrow? So we had lunch, and she sits down, and she goes, the first thing she says, you know, guys like you can be saved. I said, I didn't do anything wrong. And then she goes, well, you did, and you can be saved. And I realized she's a girl who I imitated. Maybe I want to kiss my girlfriend, huh? You were drunk making out with a girl. Like, you're going to hell faster than me. Guys like me, if I can be saved, you're in trouble.
It's a juxtaposition. It's a startling juxtaposition of truth and lies. This is a picture of my room. See the papers? That must be a genius. So, this one I love. This one is parking lot love.
Well, I'll tell you a story. When I was in, not a rock,
San Pedro.
When I was in L.A., and I didn't have a car, and I didn't realize I didn't have a place to live. I was just kind of screwing around with girls and sleeping with them and then sleeping on their couches. Because I wasn't going out with Tracy. Like, she's the only one who kind of slides a couch under me, puts a pillow behind my head and say, it's family. That's why, relax now. You can breathe. You know? Like, I want that shit. But I can't do it anymore. You know, my therapist says, you can't live the old way. It's going to kill you. Here's a funny story. I slept with this girl. She was so nice. I was out in front of the improv, and I don't talk to girls at comedy clubs. They look like ponies with bells in their heads on sticks. You know, like, whenever they look at a comic, it's not if he's funny, like the worst comic in the world, but he's cute. So they go, and I just go, I can't, when they turn around, they look at me, and I go, you poor relief to me. The word vomit might come out of my mouth. Like, I thought of the douche bag. It's a new drink. It's a shot of Jaeger and girl vomit.
But let me know how much time I have. I'm unplanned. Here's an unplanned story. So I see over this girl's house. She was very, very nice. She looked at the writing on my hand around the club. She goes, "You write on your hand." Like I was a lost genius or something. She goes, "Come with me." Went to her house. We fooled around. It seemed, I don't remember it. And I wasn't drunk. But the next day, I was sleeping on the couch. I remember saying, "Can I stay on your couch? Because I need a place to stay." She goes, "Yeah," because I didn't want to sleep with her anymore because you slept with her once. You know how that is. how do I do this? So after a couple nights, I hear this. "Come into the bedroom, bring the computer." First she went, "Come into the bedroom, bring the computer." And I said, "No, I'm okay out here." She goes, "Come into the bedroom, bring the computer." And I said, "Who's the man?" And then she comes out, she's leaning in an arched doorway, and she's the only unsexy girl I've ever met. Like she looked so ashamed of her sexuality. She tried to be sexy. She had like NASCAR underwear on. Black satin with gold stripes, but it was too big for her. Like it was her brother's underwear. Like there was dick stretch. Like it was just hanging there. And then she had socks no girl could make unsexy. White knee-high socks with blue stripes. You know those cute socks? But at the bottom were turkey toes. Like knitted turkeys on each toe. There's no such thing as Thanksgiving socks. She had Thanksgiving socks. She was from Wisconsin, of course. Thanksgiving socks, her brother's NASCAR panties, and her vagina, when her panties went up, I actually saw her vagina slouched, like in shame. Go ahead, just deal with me, ignore her, please. Throw her brother a bone. Her vagina slouched, and she's leaning against the doorway, and her skin was yellow and hanging. I don't know why I didn't notice this. The first night, you never notice shit like that. The first night, they're all 13. You heard that quote here first. The first night, they're all 13. So I walked around a lot of nights because I didn't have a place to stay. So I would go to this 1-7-7-11, where I'd go on a date. One time I went on a date, and this girl was so great. She had these big lips and like a newsboy cap, and she cocked it to the side, and we went on a date. I started to mouth off in the diner, and she said from across the diner, like, "That's funny, are you a writer? I write too." And I was like, "It's perfect." So I go over to her. She had these wooden heels on, you know, he goes wearing those wooden summer shoes, fucking kills us. Like, not burlap, wicker. Like straw sexy shoes and blue nail polish and bell bottoms, and she knew how to sit with one leg curled under the other. So we went on a date, and I'm in her car, and she turned on the dashboard. She goes, "I can't believe you like drinking coffee at the 7-Eleven parking lot in a car just like me, and we can talk." And it was great. We sat there, she turned on the light, and her dashboard looked like a fireplace. It was so warm, and she was so great. So I get out of the car for a minute, because this truck pulls up and played ZZ Top, but the uncut ZZ Top, like, in concert, and I had no idea they were fucking amazing musicians. I thought they were, like, just shtick, you know. And it played so wild that I started dancing around. And I hung out with a couple of girls in the parking lots, and I found out that people are more honest in parking lots. You get out of your car. Like when you go to a restaurant, it's like a job interview. You both sit down, and the paradigm has changed. You know, like, it's, the restaurant shoves its paradigm all over you. You know what I mean? It's like a job interview. But if you're in a parking lot, I would always pull them over and say, "I'd rather have a cup of coffee right here." And most of them would say, "What?" You know? And one time a girl said, I made out with her at a club, and she, while we were making out, she said to me, it got articulate. We were
She was talking. There's moments you gotta follow your animal instincts, and actually your whole life should be like that. Like there's moments that I didn't get an audition, and they loved me, and when I was done, the casting person was so dull, and she was rereading that I went dull too. But I knew the part. Like we gotta get Mikey. She goes, we can't. He's getting married. I said, but he's our best friend. We should. And they loved me before that, and after they were like, bye. And as I walked out of the room, I went, ah, fuck, I know this guy. And I ripped my shirt off and said, give me a smoke. And the director goes, nah. And the producer goes, give him a goddamn smoke. Gives me a cigarette. And I go, we got to get Mikey. And she goes, we can't. He's getting mad. He's being led around like a dog on a leash. And I go up to her and I separate her face from the page. Like a dog on a leash. He's my best friend. No, we can't. No, I ain't taking it. And whatever the line was, and I got the part. So I'm in the parking lot with this girl. Says I'm gonna, no, I went to eat with this. I met this girl at a club, and making out. She's talking about opera while we're kissing. How she's a rock singer. How she loves this music, that music, that. While we're making out, it was smart. It was cool. It wasn't just like making out, where a girl says you're sucking the tongue out of my neck. Because I was homeless. I make out with homeless women. They know that could be the last kiss. They know your tongue cannot come out of your neck from a kiss. They know despair and beckoning and desire and last desires and last connection. So a kiss is fucking moving through each other. You know, sucking each other's saliva out and loins and pez. Tootsie Rolls, whatever your bend is. I can't speak for everybody here. I'm a performer like you guys. I've got that charisma, you know. I may have a boatload of Burt Reynolds, but that's all I got. I'm like Stroker Ace, you know. Man, we'll be a good actor, but not even a good actor. A lot of charisma. Guess we'll be sold. Good poster. I did have Stroker Ace poster. Or I did have. So my mother ripped up my satin jacket so I looked like a hoodlum. And put up a poster of Philip Roth, because that's the only book they had, not even read. True fucking story. So I walk with this girl. So the next day she shows up, like Sarah Palin, in a blue pantsuit. And I go, who's this girl? And she goes, you ready to go out to eat? I said, sure. So we go, and we're in the parking lot. I go to kiss her. And she goes, yeah. I said, what? I said, we already know each other. We like each other. And I went to kiss her. She goes, yeah, you know, about last night. I said, what is this yeah shit? And it was the first time I finally had a new moment in my life where I heard this voice come out of me that I'd never heard. Has this ever happened? I went, let me show you the guy you're with. Let me show you the guy you're with. I just had it. You know what I mean? I went, let me show you the guy you're with. And I dropped to my knees and I started kissing and I don't know why I'm starting tonight. Kissing and licking her toes and her knee and her calves. And I saw her look down with what I call the Anais Nin eyebrow raise. She went, she looked smart for a second. It wasn't like, yeah, let's go inside. It was like, oh yeah. You know, like the first time a girl gets her ass eaten and she looks over her shoulder and goes, oh my. She's never said oh my in her life. Never raised your eyebrow. You know, if you haven't raised your eyebrow with your man, it's not. Now it's up to you to get him to hit you in places. You know, it's usually that first place where a man goes, oh man, that's a weird looking area of vagina. It's usually that, but you go like, yeah, we'll go the fuck in. And then he goes, oh, I didn't know it was so good here. Like ding dongs and ring dings. And you go, good enough. That's as close to Henry Miller as I'm going to get with you. Parking lots. Like I said, I just want to sit in that gas station railing and have a cup of coffee. I don't want to go in there. That's an interesting story, but I'll tell you more after that. But I went to 7-Eleven. I'm with this girl. ZZ Top is playing like crazy loud. It turns out the guy went there every night because I would go every night. And after that, and he was there. He was a sound engineer, and he always played his music loud in his truck like 3 a.m. It was amazing music. In the fucking parking lot. You know, it's fucking cool as shit. And I started dancing around, And I went inside, and there was this girl under the Slurpee machine reading magazines in a white cab driver, newsboy cab, like white patent leather with a purple, no, with gold shiny metallic shorts, the white socks with the blue stripes, blue metallic high platform boots that went up to her, you know, high up, so was that, and then the blue stripes, the gold shorts, the white cap, and a purple shiny bustier that didn't belong on her, with like a Capizio shirt with tire grease on the bustier, a little bit of tire grease, and so the gold and, oh yeah, red striped socks, and gold, and pink silvery shorts, and purple bustier, and a white patent leather shiny cap. And I look at her and go, she's the fucking Slurpee machine. And I'm from New Jersey, so that meant a lot. So I leaned over and I asked, and she looked up at me, and I said, I heard myself say, "You're perfect." And I meant it, man. I just was like, and she goes, "My name's Skittles." So I knew she was like a club kid slash squatter or whatever. But she was cool. I said, "I don't care. I want your number." She gives me her number. She was always late, never showed up. Turned out she was like 10. She goes, "I have to make $10 to get to where you are, so I have to blow to someone." She was like platinum white hair with that outfit and 17, 18 or something. And I wrote this. I think it was the last time I felt free. The music was playing. And all of a sudden, I yell out. I start to dance, you know, I start going, "Parking lot love, where the newspaper's getting dirty, where the water's getting dirty, the newspaper's screaming shout, and the garbage is waiting to get fucked and dumped." So that's what I did as a goof. But this is the poem I wrote. Parking lot love, with the loveliness filled. Parking lot love with the loveliness filled, sweet mean ass ramblings of your DJ tenderheart. When the world has a face like Harrison Ford butt fucking the religion filled neurotic need to die delusionally in control, pushing lies out of Mel Gibson's eyes, I create, open, and reveal the parallel universe, a simple nighttime romance. You can't be pretentious when she's about to leave you in a parking lot. For you to be judge, jury, and witness of your own night. MC Tenderheart, where the newspapers scream and shout, and the water's getting dirty, and the garbage is waiting to get fucked and dumped. And purest trash rolls to meet what lies inside the dark winds of you, the night. For you are the night's secrets, and you are finally at the end of your own night. For the secrets you finally deem non-withholdable have become uncontrollably mad at you. Redeem your lotto. Eat your quick dog. And there she is. And now was. By the Slurpee machine. And the tar top kisses the bottoms of your boots. Again. And ignored by you. It tried to tell you the dirt on your boots are sweet succulent memories. You ignored the detail of me, your never-ending road to never finding her. Go home to sleep alone again. Someday when you had enough nothing, as you pick yourself off the parking lot shining blue-black flat top, you will say, oh, the light of the moon bounces off the tar and waits for me to live with the only love I've ever known, the love that lives between moon and street. Interfered with all my fear and regret, never having said, you are my parking lot love. That's it. Now, I'm tempted to do a joke. It's not music, but that you've all seen. But I'm probably going to do I don't know if this one is clear, but it's called Cowboy. Hey kid, you like guns? It's gorgeous, the sounds of bullets. The moment they're released from their chambers. See, that's like you, the ugly, beautiful chambermaid, the beauteous chambermaid being released from her chamber. See, we're all chambermaids in this society. We're all bullets, all us bullets, deep down, sleep. But they lie in wait, we lie in wait. Wait, maybe they sleep and they're fired by the firer, by the situation. The fire is in the whole setup. My true poetic nature? This is my true poetic nature. If she's a hooker, I'm lucky. No, I'm not. Or maybe she'll be a lizard, the embodiment of my infinite nature. If she crawls, I want her. If she walks, she's too efficient. That arrogance. Maybe it's a fucking guy who comes out of the shower with donuts. And there's a story there, too. I don't always remember who I wake up with. And I met a girl, so I used to look around the room and say, who, you know, if they're in the shower, they who the fuck, or if they're asleep. And I'll look around. And I don't drink. I just, like, don't give a shit. Or didn't. I looked around the room, there was candies like M&M's, giant bowls of M&M's, and sweet tarts, and package can like Mr. Goodbar, and all the shit, and giant chocolate elves, and chocolate Santa Claus, and chocolate puppies, and all this chocolate rabbit, like, oh, you know, those big chocolate things. And so I woke up the next morning, and I said, oh, maybe she's a cheerleader, maybe she's adorable, you know. And I look around, and I go, oh, look at all that candy. Like, one time I woke up and there was nothing but the donkey from Winnie the Pooh, Tigger. I don't know. And there was like 100 of them. And I said, I gotta get out of here. She turned out to be, of course, a lawyer. Emotionally stunted. I look around, I go, God. I woke up the next morning, I said, what the fuck? All this candy. And then I looked at the bed, I was like, it was all brown, and it was like shit. I was like, oh shit, she get drunk, like shit in the bed, like, oh, what the fuck is this? And I look on the floor, it's all brown on my pants, and I go, oh no. And I yank open the fucking sheets, and there's the head of a chocolate bunny. And I realized, and I let out a scream from my whole mansion, studio, apartment, like from The Godfather. They killed my chocolate rabbit. Or her chocolate rabbit. Well, I'll fix the end. That's funny, right? You didn't expect that from a poetess. There's more, man. Oh, there's one you're going to like. Here it is. It's about where journalism went. Like, you know, journalism... Katie's here. Is telling the hat to water on the mic. Katie's here. And she's going to be a journalist. She's the smartest woman in the world. The coolest comedian. And she's, I don't know if she's doing it anymore, but she comes from shitland. Parents were shit, her fucking family shit. And I used to stay at her house. I slept on the floor, right? Or I slept with you, and I took your change every day. Right in your bed. And I pissed in your cocoa pebbles because I couldn't wait for the bathroom. She had like four fucking roommates. And I pissed in her favorite cereal. Yes. And we watched Scarface together. Like now I'm worried about my career to the point where I can't sleep. But back then I used to live like a bum with cool people. It was just fine. It was fucking great. You know, it wasn't any of this shit. Like, people ask me, do you still talk to Louis C.K.? Now I say, no, not since he got the diamond in his clit. And he's great. I don't know him anymore. But journalism is actually get killed in today's world. If they say one sentence of what's going on, they get fucking killed. I wish that would happen to comics. I thought I would die on stage. I didn't really want a life. I didn't know. But I read this article, front page of the New York Times. Front page of the New York Times. I got too much pride. he said it was about the BP. How come I forgot what BP stands for?
British Petroleum.
Yeah, don't do that, man. British Petroleum. He's still like that. Look. Like stand in line to get a closer look at your face, to bend over looking at your face. And that'd be great. And there you go. Wait, I'm next. Okay, yeah, she looks like that girl. They said they were, the front page describes the court scene that BP was undergoing, and they described it as grim. The grim suits came in. They said the corporate was looking grim. The judiciary, whatever they call it, committee was looking grim. So I said, that's what bothers me about this. And it's called grim suits. Grim guys in grim suits being all grimy and sooty. Grimmy and sooty. He did it. It's legal. So they look at legal, all grim and disappointedly, grimly disappointedly, grimmy disappointedly, all it's his faultily, all we're going to get away with itedly, and look at the Senate like, hey, we paid for your electionly, like, hey, we didn't just help you, we moneyed you. The grim suits looking at the other department of grim suits, the other department of grim suits looking at the other department of grim suits. I figured it out. The dumb psycho reporters call it grim. It's covert. We pay for your house and vacations and loser kids' education and rehabs grimly at the Senate. We keep. This is like, we keep your secrets. Yeah, don't worry. The covert, extremely intense, serious, we keep your secrets. You keep ours. And hey, you guys in that department, the foreman and the blue-collar department, we're looking grimly at corporate. You guys in that department, we, these two other departments, keep your secrets too. Don't worry, let's all, the grim, let's all just do the blaming game and keep the blame dog and blame covert. We keep your pony secrets game and smoke, blame them, smoky mirror of it's that department's fault while we grab the loophole and everyone lets it blow over with a celebrity all of a sudden being a wife beater or horny or a rapist. Or, hey, look, Tiger Woods balls. Hey, TMZ says, this celebrity is, okay. This celebrity is okay. I didn't read that right. Grim guys in grim suits being all grim and sooty. You get it? You thought you'd read the whole thing again, didn't you? Well, I would, but my family ain't here, so I don't have to run their heads through it. Shit.
Hey, Shapiro?
Yeah?
Just FYI, it's an hour.
What's FYI mean?
Just want you to know.
Oh, it's an hour and that's all I got?
No, I mean, you can keep going, but I want you to know you've done an hour.
How does that pertain to me? So, Benji said I can go longer?
You told me to tell you.
Yeah, I told you to tell me.
Benji, you can go longer.
Me. You think Benji would let me do another 10 minutes?
Definitely.
You guys don't mind another 10 minutes, right? Woo! You want to hear a political one, or like a kind of political one, or a
political, please.
What?
Political.
A political blowjob.
I don't know if I can do that. All blowjobs are political. Every, the shirts you choose to put on are political. What?
15 minutes.
Okay. Sorry, but I'd hate to have your job. I can see that going. Then she has to sleep next to me. I talk in my sleep because I have Parkinson's. Like I yell, They stole my child, and I jumped off the bed and hid under the table in my sleep. And yelled, "They're bombing us." And then I was sleeping in a bed next to Wilfred, and I went, "It's in the wastebasket." all right. I wanted to do with the incest. All right, how about this one? We'll do the blowjob first. I only like this one. I don't know if people like this one. Someone simple. All I want is someone simple. You know, she pulls her head off a table, rambles about existentialism. I say, "What?" And she says, "Guns and coke," rambles a little more and drops her head again. All I want is someone who knows, really knows, and trusts and knows. I mean, truly gets and sees and revels, luxuriates in the triumphant resounding beckonings from deep within, bellows causing rapturous, ferocious, violent self-knowing that her mouth is hot and her mind makes it move. I know, I thought this was about a blowjob when I started writing this piece. It definitely, absolutely is about the blowjob experience and Balzacian, Desaad, Samuel L. Jackson, Steiger journey. But it turns out it's about her beauteous, constant triumph that lives and lives more and unendingly in her mind and body, baby, bang, 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 boom, boom, mind and body. There she goes, walking by, bang, bang, here she is talking to me, boom, me, baby, bang, bang, don't know, and then Carlito shows up. Don't know what to do? Just listen, man, and feel the fireworks of images living your life for you. Just listen, man, and feel the fireworks of images living your life for you. The rumble of the engine, her face, those legs. Tell her what you know. Stop thinking. It's thought. That ain't thinking. And it's on the other side of living. You know, in the dumpster. But you can stay in the dumpster. You want that? Or you want her lips on you? And your hands stroking her skin, her hips, her ass. Oh, man. Dear man. Dear boy. Her eyes. Torment can't suck your cock or look at you like she can. It can't respond. That's cool.
Yeah. I think these are too personal for me. I don't think you get it.
So here's a good one. I guess there are. These blue-suited creepy crawlies. These blue-suited creepy crawlies, these scum-swilling gum-to-gum, their mouths keeping the scum rolling, their lies around the roof of their mouth, under the tongue, under the scum-licking tongue, these men, ha, these women, ha, ha, how do you do that, these women, ha, ha. Now I know it's simple, unless you're a person who needs, craves, wants to be lied to. And needs, wants, and craves knowing that he's being lied to. So he can sound smart. Ha, smart, smart. When he says, oh yeah, they all lie. Yeah, but they've been doing that for centuries. Oh, it started in the Roosevelt era. Oh, it ended and started and ended and started with the revolutionary Reagan Civil War and Cuban overtake era. When I was in that good college, did you know Lincoln had a beard? Ha, smart. Yeah, we know, you know they lie and that they've been doing that for centuries. I mean, we see a so-called man, or as I like to call them, lizards, that were taught and trained to wave and show teeth, and so mastered imbuing ever so perfect combo-like threat and flash of terror with Christmas lights. These blue blazer neon signs saying, we've been doing it for years, and we see this man or woman, they were born as these, and they wave. We must know that a blue blazer means destruction. Give me a guy that is too busy to give speeches. A guy who says, huh? Oh, okay. A speech? Here's what's going on. I mean, exactly what's going on. As he makes a speech. Vacation? No, I'm giving a speech. $20,000 dresses for my wife? Not till their wives can. And what kind of loser wants that shit anyway? Let me get this straight. The economy. $20,000 dress. 37-cent raise for the minimum wage. $20,000 dress for the inauguration. Appearances. 37 cents raise for the minimum wage. No thanks, I'm not a scumbag. And get these corporations out of my office. God, those guys are fat. blubbering, bloated, and broiled in their boiling. Get them out of my office, out of our fucking White House. And you know what? Bring those protesters in here. I want to hear what they got to say. Well, they're guaranteed to be at least much more interesting than fat, blubbering, scotch-swilling, porterhouse lobster eaters. God, they don't fucking stop. Nothing. Nothing comes out of their mouths. My yacht took a lot of hookers. My yacht took a lot of product to buy my new wife. My yacht, my wife. God, my yacht, my wife. The best hookers are in Bali. Fuck, who cares? I gotta listen to this shit? I'm the president. Golf course in Dubai. I hope we're shipping AKs in that area to somebody with a bandana or a cowboy Zapatista uniform. Anybody but a suit. No more blue suits. God, fuck! Fuck, here comes a BP guy. Look at his bloated, greasy smirk. I gotta say hi to him? Hi, Bob. What's that on your chin? Destroyed fisherman chum or a piece of a boat? Did you answer that email about who's responsible? God, oh yeah, she really loves you, I get it. She's a mistress, but she really loves you. I get it, I got it. People are all corruptible, I know. What'd you just say? What'd you just fucking say to me? People are all corruptible? That's what you fucking said to me, that's it? Fuck that, fuck this guy. I love choking CEOs. God, Jesus Christ and Allah. I love choking CEOs. Hey, let's put that in our speech. You fucking speechwriters. Let's even come up with a how-to book. Look at this. This is on TV, right? Look at his face, my fellow Americans. His face turns redder than when he heats up, when he laughs hard with those disgusting guffaws, when he screams out rationale like, it's survival of the fittest. Ha 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 ha. My fellow Americans, look at his face when being choked. It looks the same when he yells after six scotches. And some people are just bad luckers, Bob. Right? Right, Bob? Bob, right? And it's the lion versus the turtle. Luck of the fucking draw. And now the president is throttling the CEO. You wouldn't be lucky if people had access to not money, not opportunities, the same opportunities. Not funding, no, not that subsidy shit, no, not any of that shit, Bob. Your throat, if they had access to your festering, boiling, fat puke corporation, puke bile broiling, bile burning throat. To your throat, if the people had access to your throat, I, as president of these United States, hereby give each and every human in this global economy the throat of this CEO, Bob in Bob suit, and the corporate freedom of anyone to throttle, no, choke, no, and the complete freedom of anyone to throttle, no, choke. Here are the keys to the throat. Every first of the month, a throat will come in the mail. No, Bob don't wait for nothing here. Waiting, that doesn't exist for CEO throat. That doesn't exist for the CEO throat, so from now on, the citizen can choke at will. Okay, it's done. Choke when you want. Less government regulation. I don't get the last sentence. like, why ours comes in the mail, but they get theirs immediately? I mean, you say that enough times, you can't sleep at night. You know, like they get it immediately. But we're taught patience. Like, I wake up at night, and one night I walked around like this, like John Kerry. Because when Cairo fell down, he was on his fucking yacht. When Cairo fell, when the revolution, if that's what it was, he was on his fucking yacht. And he said, well, he had a cell phone. I was kayaking. And we just sit there and go, oh, he was kayaking, we're American. You know, like government shutdown. They all just had a vacation. They always take 12 days off every now and then. You know, but we as Americans go, well, we'll wait till they're done shutting down. What do you think of this government shutdown? It means the museum's gonna be closed. You know, like they could have said, we're putting a carousel in the Senate, so we're gonna be closed till it's done. And we would have said, oh, carousel in the Senate, it's pretty crazy, but you know how Republicans are, they're stupid. We'll wait. And then 10 years later, you pop out of bed and go, carousel? I believed it? You know, like, what the fuck? Like, I'm going to end now, I guess. I want to do a music. What?
Why don't you end with Comedy Noir?
Oh, yeah?
Yeah, it's a really good one.
And then I'll end with a music bit, and then you'll be like, Rick's shows are still long, and I sweat. You guys sweaty? There used to be guys that says, I don't know, who would say, yeah, we are. You guys who didn't belong in the show, you know? Like, there was always like one guy in a pink, in a salmon sweater, you know, and khaki with pleats and brushed hair on the side, and he's like, yeah, we are. And all the skaters would be in my show. When my show used to get packed. And then it stopped. Like, I stayed at the same place for 9 years. And they said, it's packed. You need to find a bigger room. And I was, like, right off the street getting clean. And I was like, why do I want a bigger room? Because it's packed. You can move up. Why do I want to move up? I never heard a career. Like, they even said your show's being considered for Off-Broadway or Broadway. There was a star next to it under Stump in New York Magazine. I was grabbing at straws. And they said, Broadway, Off-Broadway. I heard this. Your show, they want to consider it for... Because I didn't know... And, you know, Spalding Gray, Eric Bogosian, they came, Spalding Gray was wandering around. It was like 2 days before he killed himself. And I made fun of him. Which, of course, I have hollow victories instead of Emmys. What's the name of the thing?
Comedy Noir.
All right, I don't know. Let's see. There's a lot of weird things. Here's a good one.
No, do Comedy Noir.
Shut the door on hope. I rose out of the shit into a pile of stupid shit. I was a little boy in the street. They said I looked like Blackie. Child abuse like you've never seen, man. Brother, where were you for me? Where was I for anyone, including me? Into 18 years of death. I was violently somnambulant. The nightmare avoided me, and dreams kept trying to give to me. I went down into the depths of me and came back as notoriety. I am what I pretend to be. A narcissist playing innocent, silently abiding by the rules. In AA, though they said there were no rules and still say, oh, my editor put these two poems together, thought they were one. Can have it both ways. I fought for something that didn't exist, friendship. I gave up family and friends, lost and lost again, and I settled continuously for shit. All right, so what was it called? Comedy Noir. See how I snuck that in? If I duck, Tracy never sees me. That's why you get married, so you can live like that for the rest of your life. It's not her fault that I fucking use her to answer all my questions. You know, like my sponsor isn't always around from any of the programs. And Quentin Tarantino doesn't respect my Facebook comment. Pay no attention. So who's going to give me the answer? If not you.
Want Stacy to find it for you?
No. Why don't you just say, loser, hurry up. All right, 56. I had to do a reading. And she goes, I want something on film noir. I want my poets to show up and read something on film noir. Page 56. Isn't that interesting? Page 56. You think that I like the sound of my voice? It's like just the only sound I ever hear. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Man, saying thank you helps. I'm the most ungrateful, angry, depressed person. I am completely depressed and sad. I can't break out of it. I'm almost suicidal. I am suicidal. And I had to do a commercial the other day, and it was one word, thank you. So for 12 hours, I said thank you for about 1,000 takes. Because the guy kept walking by, and I put up Christmas decorations, and I'm standing by my gingerbread man and my reindeer, and I'm like looking at it, and this guy walks by with his phone. He goes, beautiful, about his phone, and I go, thank you. And then one time I did it, like it was Michelle Bachman at the face of Ginger Man, Rick Perry was a reindeer, so I heard myself go, thank you. And then I put Noam Chomsky and Ralph Nader, and I went, thank you. And then I went, and then I started going, thank you, thank you, thank you. And then I started, then they said, oh, I didn't know you could riff. So Tracy walked around like she was drunk. She was carrying, she's the best manager. She had her computer out while the director was in his chair directing, and she's kind of I never saw her do this. She's on this set in the middle of the shoot, like wandering around, leaning into the director's face like that, and doing this, and she leans into the other guy's face, the producer, and I'm like, looking at her, she's like, and then she goes back to the director, and then I finally heard myself say, what is she doing? Like, she's doing something stupid, and the director walks up with a computer, he goes, I didn't know you could do all this, you riff. I said, that's what she was doing, but she didn't go like, you know, he riffs, she was like, you know, he riffs, and walks away. And so they go, could you give us 4 minutes of making fun of the lead? Like, you finally get mad at the thanking him, and he's not talking about your shit. So, do 3 minutes clean, then whatever you want after. I never cursed anyone out, made fun of anybody clean. So it was a struggle. It was a buildup of saying, like, feather spine, monkey muffin, poodle pillow, dunny worm, knit capper, pile of nothing, less than nothing. And I went on and on until finally, and then when I had 3 minutes, he winked at him, and then I went, motherfucker, you fucking piece of shit poser, pile of scum fucking shit fuck. and they all clapped.
Close.
All right, no, comedy noir. Page 56.
Thank you.
Aren't you nice? Where do you and your husband come from? I mean, where were you born? So you don't remember? You don't remember? I'm sorry for you. This would be good. I'll read to you.
No, is that comedy noir?
It's espresso.
I know.
All right, comedy noir. I did this to kind of make fun of. No, check it out. So I saw all these people are doing their little comedy noir thing, and I wrote, I am comedy noir. Really loud. Pow, pow. Pow, pow. Yeah. fuck you. Shoot. I am comedy noir. I've killed people. I have begged people not to die. In the middle of the street, even the rain hit me hard. I went to cop school. I tried cop school. I am comedy noir. I was a prostitute for your senators. I turned girlfriends, kid brothers onto heroin. Comedy noir? You ever fuck 3 18-year-olds at once and get thrown out by the boss that was a midget because you took her mask off and got chased around the bed, around the top of the bed, swearing to him that she didn't see me? Let me keep fucking her. I'm sorry, sir. Racing out of the apartment while putting your pants on, running from a cokehead midget racehorse owner in his penthouse apartment. Were you ever afraid of a midget? You ever watch a bald, very round man, naked, short, in a Sherlock Holmes hat with a pipe, lying down on a showroom floor, convinced you find him alluring? Convinced when you just got done telling him you chant Nammyo Horengekyo because you were trying to change your life, so he offers $40 more, and then you lie down next to him, hump him, and come? I am comedy noir.
Oh, there's more.
Nick Grandy is in a pencil-thin mustache in a Ferrari. You actually took him up on his bet when he said, you think I can make 10 green lights in a row? And if I do, I don't pay for the next 10 blowjobs. Then you find yourself holding on to his ears while he's blowing you for free, and you're staring at his aquarium, which is in front of your face, angry, with the repeated thought running through your head, nobody makes 10 lights in a row, while staring into his fish tank. I am comedy noir. I have dumped bodies rolled in carpets, or a body, no bodies. I fucked your girlfriends when you sent them up to get the bags of heroin from me. They bragged about their engagement to you. They showed me pictures of you in the jacuzzi and their diamond rings. I carry 68 grams of heroin in the airport in Arizona. I put that on my resume. On my way to secret meetings, I would stare into Paul Newman's eyes on a videotape of the hustler in a shop window every day and swore I would get out someday. I robbed thousands of dollars from gangsters, hitmen, passed out from freebase, all on one bed where the safe was, asleep with guns under their pillows. I did that. I woke up in an unknown bed with a check waiting for me from Halston, which read to Rudy, my hustler name. I dropped off giant rocks of pure Peruvian to the Colombians with a note that says, you taste it, you're dead. I tasted it. I pulled cons in electric stores electronic stores, and my funky partner couldn't fit the TVs in the trunk. We were pressed for time. We had to hurry. I am comedy noir. Mother Chicken had to talk to her hens because one of them wasn't getting it up for the men, quote unquote. So I got locked in a room with a bodybuilder. He chased me around with a lamp till I blew him, but I pretended it was wood, and I...